Thank you for inviting me and asking me to contribute something to a lecture series that sounds really interesting, and I'm really honored and pleased to be here. Can you all hear me well? Okay, please do let me know if you can't.
Let's do that. Oh. It was going so well, wasn't it?
It's a very good
touch. There you go. Oh gosh, I'm so sorry.
It's a very good one.
Yeah, but that's for something else.
Okay, so I try not to move very much, which will be difficult, but I'm really pleased to be here. I will be talking about Jewish-Christian relations, because that's what I'm supposedly an expert in. So my job title is Reader in Jewish-Christian Relations, and I've chosen this title because that's what I'm really interested in. So my professional background is of a historian, and I'm particularly interested in the historical development of the relationship between Jews and Christians, particularly where things are a bit difficult and challenging. I also teach a year-long module at Canterbury Christ Church University about Judaism, sort of introduction to Judaism, and I always include one session about Jewish-Christian relations and one session about Jewish-Muslim relations, because I think it's really important to contextualize and to acknowledge that Judaism has never existed in a vacuum, but has always been engaging with, exposed to, rejecting, welcoming, you name it, with surrounding cultures. The way Judaism interacted with cultures shaped and of course changed Judaism over the millennia of its existence. What I want to do today is to focus on a number of topics, sort of give you some case studies, as it were, which I think are particularly important when we talk about the challenges, but also the opportunities of Jewish-Christian relationships, which is a complex, but also very interesting relationship. It's obvious that Christianity developed out of Judaism, but I've noticed that it still seems to be a bit of a surprise or even a shock to some Christians to realize that Jesus was a Jew. And as a statement, some people sort of, oh, yeah. But you know, it's not necessarily something people are very much aware of. Paul, Jesus' disciples, then Paul, the world in which the early Christians lived, this was a Jewish world, the way of thinking, the way of their references, their scriptures, their traditions, they were all Jewish. Key ideas, key norms, which we now recognize as part of Christianity, were taken from Judaism. So this means, and it's a very simple fact, but this means that from the very beginning there was a close relationship between the two, what then became two distinctive religions, which led to competition, tension, conflict, and violence, but also to interaction, engagement, and mutual influence and inspiration. I want to focus on a number of issues and then sort of briefly talk about them and leave room for discussion, and I'm very happily also about topics I won't be mentioning. So I want to say a few things about the difference in messianic expectations, because this is one of the big theological differences between Judaism and Christianity. I want to speak about Christian anti-Judaism, because that is, in my opinion, a really important aspect Christians need to be aware of when talking about Jews and Judaism. And this includes the Holocaust and the difficult questions: what is the Christian role in the Holocaust, and how has this impacted the relationship between Jews and Christians, in the last 70 years or so. And finally, I also want to say a few words about Jewish responses. So I also want to explore what is the Jewish perspective on what is happening. So let me start with Messianism. Unsurprisingly, there are many Jewish traditions about the coming of the Messiah, but in a nutshell, the coming of the Messiah in the Jewish tradition is envisioned as a future age of divine rule, which is exemplified by social, political peace and harmony, prosperity, and, you know, a number of traditions from the people will be particularly tall, people will be particularly beautiful, but in a nutshell, a future ideal age. As you probably know, the followers of Jesus in the first century of the Common Era expected the Messianic Kingdom to be imminent when Jesus was crucified, and the Messianic Age hadn't come. This Messianic expectation was spiritualized and turned to an internalized eschatology, if you want, and the second coming of the Messiah, of Christ, was projected into the future. And of course, as you know, the saving presence of the resurrected Christ was incorporated in the doctrine of the Holy Trinity, and this came to be at the heart of the Christian faith. From a Jewish perspective, so how this Christian development of Jewish messianic beliefs is, to put it bluntly, incomprehensible and very much at odds with the Jewish tradition. So there's no way that those two very different understandings about the coming of the Messiah can be reconciled. The followers of Jesus then created a narrative history of the life of Jesus, and they found evidence for what they believed in their own Jewish scriptures. So they went back to their own scriptures, their Jewish scriptures, because they were Jews, and interpreted the life of Jesus accordingly. A very important aspect of this is the Christian understanding of Christians as the new Israel, in contrast to the old and discarded Israel that of the Old Testament, of the Old Covenant, that is no longer loved by God. And this is a really important theological development. So the idea that the Old Covenant is broken, Jews Jews who do not accept the messianity of Jesus are no longer part of this covenant. And this has implications for the role of the Old and New Testament. So Augustine of Hippo, the very influential church father from the 4th, 5th century, he highlighted the link between the Old and the New tradition. And he said, in the Old Testament, the New Testament lies hid. In the New Testament, the Old Testament becomes clear. So they correlate very closely with each other. And from a Christian perspective, they can't exist without each other. They don't make sense from each other. But what is meant in practice from a Jewish perspective is that the Hebrew Bible, a Jewish collection of traditions, was Christianized. The Cambridge-based theologian Dr. Margie Tolstoy, she has called this an ungracious form of colonization. And she pointed out that the Christian Bible has no reference without the Hebrew Bible, so it's needed to make sense. But in this process of colonization, to use her terminology, Judaism has become dispensable, so no longer relevant and important. Historically speaking, the destruction of the temple in the year 70 by the Romans was an confirmation for Christians and an absolute disaster for the Jews. From a Jewish perspective, that this was seen as all the disasters and calamities that have befallen Jews in Jewish history, from a religious perspective, as a punishment by God for its for Jewish sins. But it first and foremost, it meant the loss of national identity. So the Jewish people focused on the temple, not only for the rituals and worship, but also very much for the sense of who they were. And in, as I often say to my students, this could have been one of the several occasions in Jewish history when Judaism could have been very easily ceased to exist. If Judaism had not managed to transform itself and shift its focus of observance from a temple-based cult towards a portable scriptural religion, which replaced the sacrifices in the temple with the studying of scripture and the observance of laws. But at this time, and this is important to note, both Jews and Christians were minorities in the Roman Empire. So neither of them enjoyed a particular favorable relationship with the Romans, as you know. There's some scholarly disagreement when exactly the two communities split decisively. So when we can say for definite, so these are Jews, these are Christians, they don't overlap. And increasingly scholars suggest that this happened only in the 4th century. So in the 4th century, the Church Fathers still warn against Christian participation in Jewish observances, which indicates that Christians might have continued to go to synagogue to follow Jewish rituals. The situation changed, of course, dramatically. So the power structure changed dramatically when Christians started to attract the upper classes and then particularly the attention of the Roman emperors. And it has been argued by scholars that Christianity really only began in the first half of the 4th century with Constantine the Great. Eliezer Berkovich, an Israeli scholar, has noted that a really important characteristic of this area was its militancy. And he has said that Christianity did not capture the Roman Empire by the power of a religious idea, but by the sword of the emperor. And perhaps it's worth noting that the symbol of the cross, this Roman instrument of torture, that became the dominant symbol for Christianity, so implies the major shift in self-understanding that has happened here. It's not the life, but the suffering of Jesus that became central in Christian theology from here onwards. And this is relevant because the focus on the suffering of Jesus meant different attention towards the Jews. And one aspect of this is increasing anti-Jewish legislation. So Jews who were seen as the source for the suffering caused to Jesus. And it is fair to say that anti-Judaism became inherent part of Christianity from the Church Father onwards. Probably all Church Fathers have some very negative things to say about Jews and Judaism. And the accusations brought forward and repeated by later theologians against Jews and Judaism included the theological guilt of the Jews, so the accusation of having killed the Son of God, the accusation that Jews are obstinate and very deliberately refuse to acknowledge the truth of Christianity, the accusations that Jews only outwardly observe empty rituals, but have no inner understanding of true religious spirituality. It's safe to assume that not very many people read these theological treatises, and the masses of Christians would not really know neither the names of these scholars nor what they were writing about. But what is crucial is that increasingly, and I'm really depicting this in very broad strokes, is that anti-Jewish legislation and agitation translated a process of lofty theologians developing these ideas, but this had an impact in anti-Jewish legislation and very specific anti-Jewish activities. So this became particularly virulent from the Middle Ages onwards in Christian Europe, where Jews were increasingly othered by a number of vicious accusations. So this started 10th, 11th century on particularly, where Jews were increasingly set apart by having to wear different clothes, different head coverings, or singled out with a yellow circle on their clothes. And obviously parallels to Nazi Germany, where Jews were forced to wear the yellow Jewish star, is obvious. And initially in the 13th century, Jews and Muslims were singled out as well. This was to prevent sexual contact between Christians and non-Christians. Jews experienced restrictions in the occupation and where they were allowed to settle, and a number of other very vicious accusations gained a lot of popularity, and these are accusations that became popular with the masses who were not interested in theological debates and discourse. One of these is the ritual murder accusation, and this is England made an original contribution to anti-Semitism by, because of the a distinction of probably having developed the first accusations that Jews murdered a Christian child in order to reenact the crucifixion of Jesus. So the case you may have heard about this goes back to the 13th century in Norwich. A 12-year-old Anglo-Saxon boy, William of Norwich, who was supposedly tortured, ritually tortured, by the local Jews to express the hatred of Christianity and to reenact the passion of Christ on an innocent Christian child. Linked to this, but different as a motive, it is a so-called blood libel. So the accusation that Jews need Christian blood for their ritual purposes, so specifically for Passover, and so that Jews would kill Christians and then use the Christian blood for sinister rituals, or that secretly they keep Christian blood to help Jewish women who have troubles in childbirth to ease their labor. And quite a few of these medieval motives have gone on well beyond the Middle Ages, so the blood libel is still quite popular in Arab countries. So the idea that Jews need non-Jewish blood for sinister purposes. Another accusation which became particularly popular and became nearly fashionable, particularly in Central Europe, is the accusation of host desecration. So after the doctrine of transubstantiation, so the idea that the bread and wine used in the Eucharist is the actual bread, the actual blood and body of Christ, the accusation that Jews tried to steal the host and torture it became relatively widespread and popped up all over the continent, and then attracted pilgrimages, source of income, etc., etc. Another accusation, it's a long list, I just mentioned the last one, the accusation of well poisoning. After the devastation of the Black Death, so the bubonic plague that killed perhaps about 60% of the European population, one assumption was that the Jews must have poisoned the wells all over Europe in order to express their anti-Christian hatred. And again, this is an accusation that Jews poison water that also come up in various Near Eastern contexts. So it has had an afterlife beyond the 14th century. I don't want to paint a too negative picture and present what the American Jewish historian Salo Whitmire Baron called the lachrymose history of Judaism, here of Jewish-Christian relations. So Baron, who was the first person to have a chair in Jewish history ever, and he criticized this focus on persecution, on suffering, and that Jewish history was not only a valley of tears. And I agree with this, and certainly in my research area, the research has shifted in its focus away from this relentless persecutions and suffering towards a more nuanced understanding of close interaction, exchange, everyday encounters between Jews and Christians that display a more nuanced picture of the relationship. However, there's no doubt whatsoever that the anti-Judaism promoted by Christian denominations, and it's not only the Catholic Church, I have to say, because that would be sort of easy, think about Martin Luther and his virulent early 16th century treatise about the Jews and their lies, where he presents a list of things one needs to do with the Jews, from which only genocide seems to lack. So this anti-Judaism was very much part of Christianity across the denominations. But so via Christianity, it became part of European culture, and eventually, provided a breeding ground, I would say, for the largest catastrophe ever to befall the Jews, the Holocaust. And this is, of course, a very complex topic, and a topic which always leads to a lot of discussion with my students, because there's so many aspects to it. And it's also an emotional topic, of course. And it's important to notice at the outset that National Socialism was not a Christian ideology, but based in pseudo-scientific, racist, and mystical romantic nationalist ideologies of the 19th century. So we don't claim it's a Christian invention as such. However, leading historians have claimed that Christian teachings about Jews and Judaism played a crucial role in preparing the mindset for the events that eventually led to the mass murder of Europe's Jews on an unprecedented scale. Chaim Okobi, who is an Israeli historian, said, as a result of the gospel story, so he refers this back straight to the New Testament, the Jews were made into an outcast, a cursed nation in Christendom, and were persecuted in all Christian lands. The massacre of 6 million Jews in Nazi Europe was only the most recent and worst of these persecutions. So from a COVID as a direct line from the New Testament to the Holocaust, that's certainly something we need to discuss. James Carroll, who is the author of a book called The Constantine Sword, The Church and the Jews, comes to a similar conclusion. Auschwitz is the climax of the story that begins at Golgotha. Another example, the American Jewish historian Daniel Goldhagen, who looked specifically into the role of the Catholic Church, and he wrote that the church leadership was guilty of incitement to murder, just like Goebbels and Streicher, for having provided the motives for many of the perpetrators. There is no evidence that any Christian religious leader endorsed the policy or the practice of genocide against the Jews as consistent with Christian doctrine. So this is important to say. So we don't have evidence of saying, okay, this is very much in line what Jesus would have wanted or something like this. However, in 1933, a group of German prelates visited Hitler. They visited him to protest against the increasing virulent treatments of Jews under the new regime, so 1933. And Hitler answered these clerics that the new regime was only putting into effect what Christianity had preached and practiced for 1,500 years. And indeed, Nazi propaganda drew on some of the worst elements in the Christian imagination of the Jews. So I spent some time talking about some of these medieval motives and these accusations which involve blood, for example. We see them in a secular, so not in a religious disguise, but in a secular transformation, very much part of Nazi propaganda. The idea that Jews secretly plot against non-Jews is also an idea which, of course, taken up by the Nazis, but just then transferred either into capitalists or communists, etc., etc. This proved utterly effective in leading the way towards the industrialized mass murder of Europe's Jews. So the Holocaust was not a Christian project, but Christians participated, Christians stood by, Christians did not protest or help. And my students tend to react quite strongly to this, and we talk about this, and I think it's also very important to mention that, of course, Christians, from Catholic priests to Jehovah's Witnesses, were victims as well, persecuted, murdered for their specific religious beliefs that encourage them to protest or to resist. And Christians, of course, because of the Christian beliefs, a small minority, but there were people who were not bystanders, and that, of course, must also be appreciated. The historian Mark Saperstein, who has published a really interesting chapter where on sort of Christian guilt for the Holocaust in a book which I edited a few years ago, and if anybody's interested, please email me and I'm very happily sent you this chapter. But he tried very carefully to tease out Christian responsibility, and he tried to be very fair in not making any blanket accusations and look very specifically who said what and did what. But he summarizes his findings by saying, This record is a sobering, depressing reflection on the failure of religious ideals in challenging and resisting evil, and the capacity of practitioners and spokesmen to pervert religious ideals in support of evil. So this is a very damning condemnation of the lack of religious ideas to inspire people to be brave and to take a stand. And but then he goes on to say, and I think that really shows how very much he tries to be balanced and fair. He said, yes, we can ask the question, why did so few Christians try to defy the Nazis and protect the Jews? But he adds, we might just as appropriately ask, how under these circumstances did some Christians find the courage to help Jewish victims? After the war ended and the atrocities of the Holocaust became widely known, a lot of soul searching, particularly in Jews in the continent, began about Christian guilt, Christian responsibility, the role of Christian theology in contributing to these events, in enabling these events, in teaching about Jews and Judaism in certain ways. So individual Christians and churches raised difficult questions regarding their role and their responsibilities. And this had an enormous impact on Jewish-Christian relations, Christian theology, and also theological positions in relation to Jews. So we have seen explicit admissions of guilt, so for complicity or the lack of resistance to persecution, murder of Jews. Another issue, the impact on Christian theology. So leading theologians have started to rethink Christian doctrines, particularly Christology. Christian churches have issued a number of statements and initiated conversations with Jews. Roman Catholic Church, the Churches of the Anglican Communion, the World Council of Churches, and some of the National Orthodox Churches. And immediately after the Holocaust, after the end of the war, Jews and Christians met in Switzerland as a neutral, central location to discuss what had gone wrong and how could Christian churches make sure that there would not ever a repetition of these events. And these discussions contributed to the establishment of the International Council for Christians and Jews, and ultimately also fed into a very important Roman Catholic document, Nostra Aetate, which was issued in 1965 by the Second Vatican Council. You may not be terribly interested in the positions of the Roman Catholic Church, but since the Roman Catholic Church is the largest Christian denomination, and the discussions about the role of Pope Pius XII before the Holocaust, during the Holocaust, and particular also afterwards, when, for example, as we now know, the Vatican aided leading Nazi criminals to escape Europe. So this is important, that the Catholic Church was relatively early rethinking its stance. So the Second Vatican Council, which was a very important church council, whose aim was to rethink, from liturgy to doctrine, but also importantly the relationship of the Catholic Church to non-Christian religions. And very importantly, the Church revoked the teaching that the Jews as a nation are responsible for deicide. I read you the translation because it's an interesting one. True, the Jewish authorities and those who followed their lead pressed for the death of Christ. Still, what happened in his passion cannot be charged against all the Jews without distinction, then alive, nor against the Jews of today. Although the Church is the new people of God, the Jews should not be presented as rejected or accursed by God, as if this followed from the Holy Scriptures. And the text goes on to say that all forms of anti-Semitism are unacceptable and incompatible with Catholic teaching. When I present it to my students, they always are quick to point out that the way this text is phrased is somewhat problematic. It's not a clear-cut admission of guilt or, exploitation of Jews, but it's difficult. We shouldn't underestimate the importance of this text for the relationship with Jews, representing over a billion of the world population. It was hailed as a milestone in Jewish-Christian relations and really signaled a change of attitudes within Catholic Church. What is the responsibility, or what should be the responsibility of Christian churches be? So the Holocaust occurred in a Christian civilization, and it's crucial that Christians increasingly reassess the legacy of anti-Judaism in their faith tradition. So Marjorie Dolster, I've already quoted, she has argued that Christians need to engage in learning and unlearning. Learning about Judaism as a dynamic faith, as a living faith, so not just something antiquated, important because they're the people of the Bible, but with no relevance for today. With no knowledge of how do Jews live today, with no knowledge of the post-biblical tradition, and let's face it, that's a good 2,000 years of Jewish tradition, of Jewish history, that Christians do need understand. So if you don't really understand the rabbinical period, which post-biblical period, immediate post-biblical period, you don't understand the last 1,500 years of Judaism. So Christians should engage in learning about Judaism. But she said Christians also need to unlearn deeply ingrained liturgical and theological habits that perpetuate anti-Semitism and contributed sort of to setting minds in a very anti-Jewish mode. So she called it the teaching of contempt, and it's argued that Christian churches, Christian education must overcome this teaching of contempt towards Jews and Judaism. I'm coming to my final point, and that is the Jewish side. So a lot of things about sort of the Christian side of this relationship, but the relationship after all. It's not a symmetrical relationship. So first in terms of power, of numbers, about 2 billion Christians worldwide in, 33,000 different denominations, and 13, 14 million Jews, so very, very unequal numbers, but also because of the historic relationship, the historic effects of Christians in relation to Jews. So this is not symmetrical. And quite honestly, many Jews feel uneasy about interfaith dialogue, about engaging with Christians, about learning about Christianity, because they fear there might be an underlying agenda historically. They have often experienced Christian attention as an attempt of mission and conversion, and it requires trust that if you engage in interfaith dialogue, your Christian partner would not try to change you, try to convert you. But the serious efforts which have been made by Christian theologians to get the house in order have not gone unnoticed. And there has been a lot of cooperation, so among scholars, but also among educators. And this has really
proved to be a very fruitful field, and what has happened in academia for quite a few decades now is also beginning to have an impact in the theological world and beyond. One very interesting response, a Jewish response to Christianity, is a statement which was published in the year 2000 in two American newspapers and signed by a number of Jewish scholars representing basically the majority of contemporary Jewish denominations. So from the Orthodox, although not the actual Orthodox, from the Orthodox to Reform and Reconstructionism in America. And this statement was called the Dabur Emet, Hebrew, speak truth, speak the truth, and the subtitle, a Jewish statement on Christians and Christianity. You'll find it very easily online. The version which was published, if you're interested in this. The text begins with stressing important similarities, shared traditions between Jews and Christians. It stresses that Jews and Christians worship the same God and seek authority from the same book, the Hebrew Bible. Interestingly, it then goes on to talk about the state of Israel, sort of the third point in this declaration, and begins this paragraph saying, Christians can respect the claim of the Jewish people upon the land of Israel. They then highlight the shared moral traditions of Judaism and Christianity. The text does not shy away from controversial issues, so it mentions the Holocaust as really a major event of recent history in the relation between Jews and Christians. They say that Nazism was not a Christian phenomenon. And they also, theologically speaking, are very careful to not try to diminish the differences. And this is really important. So you can only engage with each other if you also honestly acknowledge what is different. And they reassure, and they write about the humanly irreconcilable differences between Jews and Christians, so in terms of the coming of the Messiah, for example. The text is also a message towards other Jews, so they reassure Jews that a new relationship between Jews and Christians will not weaken Jewish practice. And that is also important. As I said earlier, the Jewish fear that we Christians sort of expect us to change ourselves in order to comply with their expectations of how we're supposed to be. They also say, we respect Christianity as a faith that originated within Judaism and it still has significant context with it. We do not see it as an extension of Judaism. Only if we cherish our own traditions can we pursue this relationship with integrity. And it ends with the plea that Jews and Christians must work together for justice and peace. So this text was put out there, and there were a lot of interesting responses and reactions to it. So Christians obviously had a lot of interest in it, but it's also interesting how this led to inner Jewish discussions. And it became actually quite a controversial text. I like discussing the text with my students because it tells us about Jewish priorities, Jewish identity, about how a new appraisal of Christians and Christianity might perhaps lead to a rethinking of certain Jewish values or of a different Jewish self-understanding. Some Jewish scholars have criticized that the text uses very little specific Jewish terminology, and they felt that the Jewish scholars were sort of watering down Judaism for the sake of Christian readers, and therefore sort of diluted Jewish values. Others felt that the text implies the Jews should reassess their view of Christianity in light of Christian reassessment of Judaism. And they didn't like this assumption, so that you have to reciprocate their sort of Christian soul searching with Jewish soul searching, and they objected to the idea that there's an equal balance of power, as it were, where both sides need to engage in soul searching. So this debate continues, and I think this is a sort of an interesting case study of a very conscious Jewish attempt to take a position, to engage with Christian theologians, but you know, with Christians who are willing and interested in hearing a Jewish perspective. So I promise I will not overrun, so that's why I'm really coming to my conclusion. And very briefly, I want to highlight, or mention, not much more than this, a few issues which I think they will be challenges for Jewish-Christian relations in the future. I think one is the rethinking of mission in Christian churches, particularly in the evangelical spectrum, is the attempt to try to convert Jews ever appropriate? Do Christians have an understanding how threatening this is for Jews? So a second point, Israel. So I've not mentioned Israel very much so far, but many Christians feel very strongly about Israel. On the one hand, among some particular American churches, has a very strong identification with Israel for their own eschatological purposes. On the other hand, particular Protestant churches have become very engaged with the so-called BDS, boycott, sanctions, investment movement, so calling for boycotts of Israeli goods, Israeli scholars, etc., to supposedly support the Palestinian case. Many Jews feel that this is just old anti-Semitism in new clothes. And another last point I'd like to mention is Islam. It's probably fair to say that a lot of work has gone into Jewish-Christian relations in the past decades. And the relationship probably has never been as amicable and friendly as it is now. But there is a third Abrahamic religion, which is arguably the most distrusted religion in Europe today, and that's Islam. And I would argue that both Jews and Christians need to engage with Islam as a triangle of engagement. And these issues are difficult. So they would include addressing Muslim anti-Semitism, which is on the rise, addressing Jewish distrust of Islam, but also I think learning and unlearning Christian and Jewish stereotypes towards Muslims and Islam. But I think this dialogue, or this trilogue, could learn a lot from what Jews and Christians have been done in the past decades.